won the 1982 World Series, defeating the Milwaukee Brewers in a dramatic seven-game series. The city of St. Louis gave the Cardinals and series MVP Darryl Porter a hero's welcome. Darryl Porter, who came to the Cardinals as a free agent in 1980, had a tremendous series. Rebounding from personal problems, Porter batted .286, hitting this home run in Game 6 as the Cards evened the series at 3. In the deciding seventh game, George Hendrick singled home Mike Ramsey to break a 3-3 tie in the sixth inning. They went on to win 6-3. Bruce Sutter, the Cards' relief ace, saved the victory, and the Cardinals had their first world championship since 1968. The Washington Redskins lost only one game en route to their first NFL title since 1942. On their return home, an estimated 500,000 people jammed the streets of Washington, D.C. to cheer their hero. In Super Bowl 17 in Pasadena, they beat the Dolphins 27-17 behind the passing of quarterback Joe Theismann, who threw two touchdown passes, this one to Alvin Garrett. MVP John Riggins broke the Super Bowl record, rushing for 166 yards, including this fourth quarter touchdown on a fourth down burst, which put the Skins ahead for good. Theismann had waited many years for this moment. Indeed, the Redskins were number one. And today, from Key Biscayne, Miami, Florida, it's the Super Teams. The World Series champion St. Louis Cardinals take on the Super Bowl champion Washington Redskins.
The Superstars.
Today, for the first time, the Super Teams will be brought to you from Key Biscayne, Florida, the site, however, of many previous Superstars encounters. Today, these events will be contested, ending with the always popular tug of war. And as well as a lot of laughs, money, much of it is on the line for these two 10-men teams. The winning bonus represents a $30,000 difference. Hello again, everyone. I'm Frank Gifford, and welcome to this, the ninth edition of the Super Teams. The Super Teams, matching the best from the world of baseball, that, of course, the St. Louis Cardinals, the World Series champions, and the best from the world of football and the recently crowned Washington Redskins, their victory in the Super Bowl over the Miami Dolphins. And over the series, there have been four victories by the baseball players. There have been three by the football players, and we have won this even. So we could pull it all even today if the football players can pull it off. Working with me today, well, they used to call him Mr. October. We now call him the Fallen Yankee, but he wears the wings of the Angels, the man who's hit 464 career home runs. None other than Reggie Jackson himself. And Reggie, I don't have to ask you who you might be pulling for here today. Are you a partisan baseball man?
Oh, Frank, I don't know, but I think that I want to be realistic and honest to the fans that are listening today. You know, the baseball players, being a baseball player myself, I know that the most difficult thing to do, if everyone knows, is hitting a baseball. You know that. You're a football player. So I'm going to go with the George Hendricks and the Darryl Porters, who's the most valuable player of the World Series, and the hot hand that he's got and had all winter. I'm going to pick the baseball players to win this.
All right, that's a bit of a surprise coming from Mr. J. And also working with Reggie and myself will be Richard Todd, coming off his finest year with the New York Jets. He was one game away, the one game of flood down here in Miami. We're operating here in Key Biscayne, of course. And Richard, I have to ask you, you've had a chance to look at these Redskins. What do you think?
Well, I have to disagree with Reggie. I believe the football players are by far the better athletes. I think the baseball players may be a little quicker because they have to run a lot shorter distance, you know, to the bases, but I think the overall strength program and also the long distance running, anything over 90 feet, whatever the distance from first base to second base is. So I have to go around, you know, go along with the Mark Mosley's and Joe Theismann's.
Okay, I remain absolutely neutral. I will tell you one thing, we're going to have a lot of fun. And we're going to watch a lot of great names from the world of baseball and the world of football performing. Here's the Cardinals lineup. We'll be meeting them all a little later. Darryl Porter is their elected captain. And for the Washington Redskins, how about Big Dave Butts? He only goes about 300 pounds for this competition. Quarterback Joe Theismann is here. And Mark Mosley, the record-setting field goal kicker, has been elected captain for the Washington Redskins. Competition about ready to get underway. It's the running relay. Six-man team from each team. They will run at varied distances, a total of 3/4 of a mile, and culminated by a 1/4-mile run. Those will be the distances, and those are the competitors. And Reggie Jackson, we have leading off for the Redskins at 110 yards. Quarterback Joe Theismann, he'll be in against Mike Ramsey, the fine utility man for the Cardinals. You're an old Arizona State track man. What do they try and do? Get the lead quickly?
Absolutely, Frank. You have the 110-yard dash here.
Good start, and Joe Theismann, who used to return punts for the Redskins, is surprisingly quick, Reggie, for a quarterback.
Yes, he is, Frank. He's used to scrambling, I'm sure. Let's make note that they have to stay in the lane all the way around the first lap as they make the handoff to Alvin Garrett and Tommy Herr.
Alvin Garrett, the speedy wide receiver, Tommy Herr, the second baseman for the Cardinals, and look at Garrett go, Reg.
It's obvious now why he was playing the last part of the year. Of course, a couple of injuries, but a great deal of speed as the handoff goes now to the first 220 men.
And that's Mike Nelm for the Redskins, an outstanding return man for the Redskins. George Hendrick, the right fielder, is staying right with him, Reg.
6'5". He's got great strides there, Frank. You'd be surprised how long 220 yards is until you try to run it full speed.
Coming up now, the pass will be to Mark Mosey for the Redskins and Ken Obergefell for the Cardinals. And trouble, and Hendrick goes down. They missed the pass, and Mark Mosley has taken the lead.
They had a problem there. Hendrick just seemed like he ran out of gas to me, Frank, and fell down. And now, of course, Mark Mosley off there. And all the Redskins have to do now is just not make a problem with a pass or have a problem with a pass.
Third baseman Ken Obergefell trailing by perhaps 40 yards. Mark Mosley running comfortably. His pass next will be to Tony Peters, a good, outstanding former track man. Reggie, he'll go 220. And Obergefell will get it to Willie McGee. He might be able to pick up something for them, the great center fielder for the Cardinals.
I think what the Cardinals are going to have to hope for, Frank, as we look at the nice even stride of Willie McGee, youth on his side, being 24 years of age, is for the Redskins to have a problem with a pass and maybe drop a baton. Other than that, it'll be smooth sailing for Charlie Brown as Tony Peters will hand off to him as he starts the 440.
Look at the stride now on wide receiver Charlie Brown as Willie McGee will hand it off to pitcher John Stuper, and it will be 1/4 mile for Brown, 1/4 mile for Stuper, the Redskins in command.
You'd be very surprised, I said earlier, about how far some of these distances seem. 440 yards, oh, I can handle that quite easily. When you get out there under competition where you have to go full speed and you run out of gas quite quickly, I think that the guy that winds up with a 440-yard dash, Frank, is the guy that really doesn't get a chance to say so much, winds up with a short straw because it sure takes a lot out of you. John Stuper, 22 years of age, he got the short straw today.
And Charlie Brown had a very comfortable 1/4 mile. Barring anything we can imagine, the Redskins are going to win this first competition. Remember, $5,000 to the winner of each of the 7 events, $2,000 to the loser. Charlie Brown for the Redskins, they have won the running relay. And they win it easily because of the missed pass between George Hendrick and Ken Obergefell. John Stuper finishing out for the Cardinals. The Redskins winning the running relay, but I'll tell you one thing, Reggie. I was impressed with Alvin Garrett. When Joe Theismann gave him the baton in the first 110-yard leg, he really hit himself an afterburner. Let's go back and look.
Maybe you can say the Redskins won the race on the drop baton by Hendrick, but here's their first lead. Alvin Garrett showing tremendous speed right here as he goes by Tommy Herr almost like he's standing still. Herr, a second baseman with real good speed, but look at Mr. Garrett, known as Little Smurf. And Frankie really shows us something special here. The Redskins off to a real good handoff right there. As they come on, Hendrick trying to come up and catch up. He loses his hat, but to no avail.
Joe Theismann, the bubbly one, the effervescent one, as he moves around congratulating his teammates, much as he does on the football field. The helmets and the pads were off when earlier Captain Mark Mosley introduced us to his teammates.
Hi, I'm Mark Mosley, captain of the world champion Washington Redskins, and I want to introduce my teammates this year. We got the Smurfs first, downtown Charlie Brown. Smurf number one, wide receiver, doing a great job for us. Smurf number two, Alvin Garrett. Good little man, catches a lot of passes. Then we got, Bigfoot. Bigfoot Dave Butts, defensive end. They call him the monster. And one of the hogs, George Stark. Come on, George, smile for
Head
us.
Hog.
Head hog, that's right, grandfather hog. And then we got the new addition this year as one of the small hogs, Russ Grimm. Great guy, does a super job for us. And then one of our linebackers, Rich Malott, who is on our injury reserve this year, came in with a bad ankle, but we're going to let him participate anyway. Then we got Mike Nelms, who is our return specialist, Pro Bowl 3 years in a row, doing a great job for us this year and looking forward to next year. Tony Peters, defensive back, another Pro Bowler this year. And then we got, last but not least, quarterback Joe Theismann.
Boy, you did a good job.
Hey, thank you. We were starting to introduce ourselves as the blue team, but...
That's because I couldn't get it right.
But Joe did a great job for us this year. Then we got down here. This is our co-captain, little Patrick Theismann, kicker, Washington Redskins.
Smile.
Come on, Patrick. Smile for us.
0 lead over the St. Louis Cardinals. They won the running relay in a time of 2:31.60. That's 9 seconds off the Cincinnati Bengals record set last year. But they were never pressed, Reggie. Because of the fall, George Hendry trying to get the baton to Ken Oberfell. Here it is.
Frank, George Hendry, to me, just seemed to run out of gas. Coming down that last stretch there, you could see his back starting to straighten up. His legs got wobbly, and he starts leaning forward there and just comes out of control. Drops the baton and falls, and luckily does not get hurt. He saves himself and doesn't get hurt, with spring training only a week away.
And that missed pass cost the Cardinals any opportunity they had of winning the running relay. MVP of the World Series, Darryl Porter. He's the acting captain of the Cardinals. Earlier he introduced his teammates.
I'm Darryl Porter, captain of the world champion St. Louis Cardinals, and I'd like to introduce you to you some of my teammates that you'll be seeing today on the super teams. First of all, we've got one of our starting pitchers, Mr. Bob Force. I don't think Bob's going to say anything. Next, we got George Hendricks. George is better known by the press as Silent George, and I'd like to ask old George a question. Okay, George, I understand. Next, we got Tom Herr. Tom's a second baseman on our ball club, and he's a great ball player. He's a young ball player, and he's a leader on our team. Tom, we hope you help us out down here. This is old Dane Orge, a good buddy of mine, and only one thing down here I hope to do, and I don't care about the Washington Redskins, but as long as I beat Dane Orge's time on the obstacle course, then everything will be okay.
We'll get along then.
This is old Jim Cott. Old Jim Cott. Sorry about that, bud, but the truth's the truth, and it's good to have you down here. What I wanted to know was you was going to be involved in the obstacle course, and we wondered what happened.
I got a white man's disease, couldn't go over the wall.
Well, okay, we can understand that too. Here we got Willie McGee. Willie is a great young prospect on our ball club. He did a great job this year for us, and Willie can fly, and I know Willie's going to do a good job in the obstacle course for us. Will, it's good to have you down here, bud.
Good to be here.
Next, we got old Ken Oberfell, better known right now as Grizzly Adams. Grizzly, good to have you, bud.
Nice to be here, Darryl.
We got old Mike Ramsey next. Mike is known as a super sub on our ball club. He can do everything off the bench. He's a great ball player.
Hey, thanks, Darryl.
Next, we got old John Stuper. John, I don't know what to say about old John. He's a great pitcher. He's a young guy, and he's just going to be a phenomenal pitcher one of these days. John, hope you help us out down here.
Thanks, Captain.
Okay. There we go.
The obstacle course coming up is a lot of fun to watch. Not so much fun if you happen to be a superstar. Of course, there'll be six heats, each heat matching one Cardinal, one Redskin, the lowest combined time of the six-man teams to determine the winner. Earlier, Reggie Jackson gave us a tour of the course.
They've got their green monster in Fenway Park. Down here at Crandon Park, at the super teams, they've got a red and blue monster. The obstacle course, a test of strength, jumping, agility, and speed. They'll come off that wall, come through this tunnel, go as fast as they possibly can, and come to the monkey bars. Grab the first rung. Of course, grab the last one. If you don't, you're going to come up with a penalty. Then some speed and, of course, some agility here. Make sure you get all your feet through the tires. Maybe the football players will have an advantage there. But then some quickness required and some speed. They'll come to the water jump. They'll have to jump over this. Certain distance you have to go. If not, you'll wind up with a penalty. And, of course, I like when they come to the high bar. You'll see all different types of styles here. You'll see a hurdle, maybe a roll, maybe a tumble. And a lot of times, unbeknownst to the contestant, he'll knock the bar off. From there, he'll go over the hurdles, doesn't matter if you knock them down, and across the finish line.
Penalties are 2 seconds for an error in the first five heats, and that is doubled in the final heat. Richard Todd, now you've been over this before in Superstars competition. What's the toughest part of it?
Well, I think the hardest part would be the wall. Once you get over the wall, you've got the course lead.
All right, we'll watch in the first heat. Joe Theismann, he is familiar from previous Superstars competition with the course. The course, by the way, is changed here in Super Teams. Instead of having the blocking sled, they use the monkey bars. And here's Tommy Herr. He was just in the recently concluded men's Superstars, so he, too, is familiar. Wife Kim looking on, cheering for her husband and the Cardinals. The course is 95 yards long, and over the years, we've watched some great names from the world of sport humble thoroughly over these 95 yards. Good start. Here's your wall, Richard.
That wall is 12 feet high, and it really doesn't look that high unless you're up in front of you. You've got to get over the wall quickly to have a good time.
And Herr and Theismann came over right together. Now the monkey bars, and Theismann had trouble.
He's got to regress the ball where he fell off, or there'll be penalties involved.
And now through the tires, Theismann trying to make up time. The water jump, and then it'll be the high jump. Herr is over. Theismann knocked it off.
If he would have got over the high jump bar there without knocking it down, he would have had a much better time.
He sure would have. I think he was trying to make up too much time. He will be penalized at the high bar, and he will also be penalized at the monkey bars. Theismann's time, 33.10 with a penalty.
Gee whiz.
For Tommy Herr, his time, 30.15, so he will win his heat. Let's go back to the high bars, Richard, and watch Theismann on the left.
All right, he's got to grab the first bar, which he does. Now he has a little trouble. Now he has to re-grasp it where he dropped off, which he doesn't.
Which he did not do. And then, of course, he got behind and trying to make up time, as we'll see in just a moment. He's pulling up on her at this point, but now he'll take off the high bar. He was just trying to go too fast.
Well, he's trying to make up a lot of time, and he's really not that tall, so he can't be that great of a hurdler.
So Joey Theismann loses 2.95 seconds to Tommy Herr. Reggie's with both of them.
Isn't that exciting to do?
Yeah, that's a lot of fun, I'll tell you. I wasn't too worried about the wall beforehand, but I got the rope caught between my legs going over that thing, or else I'd have got over it a little bit better. I kind of got my feet tangled up a little bit before the hurdle and fell down. It cost me a couple seconds, but other than that, I felt I had a pretty good run.
Joe, you've done the obstacle course before, but you had a lot of problems today. Were you trying to scramble away from somebody?
No, the only time I've done the obstacle course, we didn't have the monkey bars. You know, we've always had a blocking sled, and I guess I'm a little bit easier hitting people than I am trying to grab at things on top of me. I missed the bar, and that sort of set off my timing, and then I tried to make up for it going over the hurdle, going over the water jump, and then trying to take the bar on a hurdle type of a move instead of diving over, because I had tried to catch Tommy, and fortunately he slipped and fell, or else it wouldn't even been that close.
So after the first heat, the Redskins are down by 2.95 seconds. Ready now for the second heat, and we should have some speed in this one. For the St. Louis Cardinals, it'll be infielder Mike Ramsey. He'll be running in the blue lane. They alternate lane assignments, so there can be no possible edge. There's Merrill Ramsey on hand to watch her husband's performance, and Charlie Brown. He should perform well here, Richard.
Charlie Brown should be very good. First of all, he's a wide receiver, so he's got great speed, great leaping ability, and plus his arms are so long. If he can get a good jump and grab the rope up, he should be able to get over the wall very quickly.
What a role he played in the Redskins' success this year. Super player. Ramsey's at the wall first. Oh, you called her, Richard. Look at Charlie Brown. Mike Ramsey's still having a problem getting over. Big lead now by Charlie Brown.
If he can just be under control, not make any mistakes, he has a good lead. He'll have a very good time.
Now through the tires. Charlie Brown being very deliberate. He does not want to pick up penalty seconds at the water jump.
Well, he clears that easy. He's a wide receiver. He can jump.
And he took it with the Weston roll, and there's going to be penalty seconds for Mike Ramsey. Mike Ramsey is going to not only lose time to Charlie Brown on the running of the course, he's going to lose 2 seconds of penalties. Mike Ramsey penalized 2 seconds at the water jump. Let's take a look at it.
We see it here. Charlie's fixing to show his great leaping ability over the high jump bar. Look at the form and technique on that. In the background, Ramsey's trying to go the water jump, barely touches the line. There's a penalty.
Across the air by Mike Ramsey, his total time, 33.64. Meanwhile, Charlie Brown whistled through the obstacle course, his time, 28.63. So the Redskins have turned it around. They now have a 2.06, four more heats to come. A little counseling for Alvin Garrett. We've concluded one event of the Super Teams competition here at Key Biscayne. The Redskins have won the running relay. They lead 1-0. And after 2 of 6 heats of the obstacle course, the Redskins have a little over 2 seconds advantage. 4 more heats to go. The lowest combined time to determine the winner. And Alvin Garrett will be running in the blue lane.
5'7". And that could be a problem for him. He's in against Darryl Porter. Darryl Porter, the catcher for the St. Louis Cardinals. His wife, Deanne, looking on. And the newest Porter, Lindsay, also on hand. That height could be a problem at the wall for Al, Richard.
Garrett's only 5'7", so the disadvantage for him is definitely going to be getting over the wall.
They hit it right together. Oh, Garrett went way up on the wall when he took it, so he did not have the problems we thought he would. But he is behind Porter at this point.
He's behind right now, but he has more speed than Porter. That's was seen in the running relay. So he should be able to make up some time here, especially going through the tires. That's an old football drill.
Porter very good through the tires, and now the water jumped, and Porter just forgot all about jumping over the water. They both clear the high bar. It's going to be very close. Porter will get 2 seconds of penalty at the water jump. And for Porter, his total time, 30.35. Alvin Garrett, 29.07. The Redskins extending their lead now after three heats. And, Richard, I don't think Darryl Porter even considered jumping over the water jump.
Darryl did surprisingly well in the event up until the water jump. It looked like that he had practiced before, and he knew that he couldn't get over the water jump, so why even try?
He just stomps his way right through it.
He gets over the high jump here very well. Look, he loses his glasses going over.
Reggie's at the finish line with both Alvin Garrett and Darryl Porter.
You're supposed to be in shape. Your football wasn't that long ago, just a month or so. You're not that tired, are you?
Hey, this is a tough course right here. It wore me out, you know.
Making up some good ground, though. You fellas are a little over 3 seconds ahead, and you started out about 3 or 4 seconds behind.
Well, I just tried to go through the course without getting any penalties and hope that I stayed close to Dave here.
Darryl, you were coming... Darryl, you were coming along quite well there, and then all of a sudden you came up with a penalty, and you guys losing ground now.
I knew by running it yesterday, Reggie, that I wasn't going to make the water. So I thought I'd just kind of maybe fudge on it a little bit and go ahead and concede the 2 seconds and try to make the rest of the course, but it didn't work out too well.
Okay, Captain, you better go back in there, up there, and give them some strategy and tell them how to catch up.
Yeah, we're going to try to figure out. I tell you, this course, I ran this thing 3 years ago, and it's a whole lot harder now than it was then.
Good luck.
Thanks.
It gets harder with each passing year, Darryl. Right now, the Redskins have extended their lead to 3.34 seconds. Not too much of a lead, still with three more heats to come because you can lose seconds so quickly. Dane Org, the great pinch-hitting outfielder. His wife, Gay, is here, as his young son, Seth. They'll be watching as Org goes against Mark Moseley, the record-setting field goal kicker of the Redskins. And you know, Richard, as we look at his wife, Sharon, Moseley is a pretty fine athlete.
Mark is a great athlete. When you look at him, you don't think of a kicker. You think of a running back.
You'll hear from the kickers on that one. Good start. Org quickly up the wall. Moseley with a little bit of a problem. Org will be over first. But Moseley not bad. Now the monkey bars. That's been a problem.
That's been a problem, but not for these two guys. They got over the monkey bars very quickly.
And both of them through the tires, the football drill, very quickly. And they're both over the water.
Moseley had a better jumping ability there. He got over the high jump bar. It's real good form, but he just can't make it up.
Dane Org will win this heat, taking it from Mark Moseley. Dane Org's time, 28.87. Moseley, 30.20. And Org has brought the Cardinals back by nearly a second and a half. Mark Moseley, no other kicker ever had the year he had, setting the NFL record of 23 consecutive field goals without a miss. Let's go back against the Giants, a game winner, to break the record of Garo Yepremian. That is 21st, and again, he went on to kick 23. I talked with him earlier.
Set the record 23 in a row. That's hard to believe. There's a lot of kickers that haven't kicked that many conversions in a row. Over a decade, what have you lost, if anything?
Well, I hope I haven't lost much of anything. I think what I've gained is a lot of confidence. I think I've, from the first year that I came in the league, I've gained some strength. I'm a lot stronger now.
It is in the head, isn't it?
Oh, it's 95% of it is in the head. If you don't think you can kick it, you're not going to make it for sure. So I think what I've really gained is confidence and more strength. And I feel better now than I did 10 years ago when I came in the league, or 13 years ago when I came in the league. And I feel like I've got a lot left, and I was really pleased, if nothing else, in the Pro Bowl that I got this first time I've been able to kick off all year. You know, the Redskins have a young kid they brought in. They wanted to kind of save my leg this year, so I didn't even work out on kickoffs. finally in the Pro Bowl, I got an opportunity to kick off, and I really, really enjoyed it. I guess I get as much of a thrill out of kicking off as I do kicking field goals.
Mark Mosley, the last of a dying breed, a straightaway kicker, and he is a great one. The Redskins have a little over 2 second lead, and we have two heats remaining. And coming up, we have some smoke in this one. Mike Nelms will be running in the blue lane. Of course, the great return man for the Redskins and a former track star at Baylor University. There's his wife, Michelle. She's with us. And Willie McGee, the man who patrols the center field for the St. Louis Cardinals. He, too, has a lot of speed, Richard.
This should really be a fun heat to watch. They both got a lot of speed, and Nelms was a high jumper in college.
Good start, and they both hit the wall. Look at
Nelms.
Shades of Edwin Moses. That's the first man we saw do that. He did not use the rope, and Nelms is way out in front now of Willie.
Oh, he's got a great lead now. Just amazing the way he got over the wall. Did not even touch the rope.
Let's watch it at the high bar. He hurdles it. Nelms is going to have a sensational time. There are no flags up. There'll be no penalties. And poor Willie McGee, he was just blown out with that move of Nelms at the wall. I don't blame Willie McGee for saying, hey, I don't want to even be in this one. Mike Nelms' time, incredible, 22.45. And for Willie McGee, he gets 2 seconds of penalty, 29.60. Let's take a look at this move at Nelms at the wall once again.
This is amazing right here, the way he just jumps, does not even touch the rope, and grabs the top of the wall and pulls himself over. That's how he won the race right there.
Boy, it was all over right here. Nelms over the wall, didn't even use the rope, and now the Redskins have a commanding lead. We'll look at Nelms again at the high bar. Completely hurdled it.
He just stepped right over it like it wasn't even there. What an athlete.
Poor Willie. Back to the drawing board, and maybe back to the drawing board for the Cardinals, because all of a sudden the Redskins are almost uncatchable. They have a big lead, and we have one more heat to go, but anything could happen. The final heat of the obstacle course is coming up, and the St. Louis Cardinals are in trouble. They trail by over 9 seconds. And they are going to send George Hendrick, the fine outfielder, to the starting line to try and recapture some of those seconds. And since the penalties are doubled in this final heat, well, who's to say? And Hendrick will be in against the Pro Bowl safety man from the Washington Redskins, Tony Peters, and I'm sure that his teammates have all surrounded him and saying, look, Tony, just get over it, get through it, and don't make any mistakes. Because when you double those two-second penalties, it can add up rather quickly.
Runners to your mark.
We'll go with
them.
Set.
Good start. Tony Peters blazing up to the wall, and he gets in trouble immediately, and Hendrick is over the wall first, and Peters having a lot of trouble with that big wall. Hendrick way out in front. But again, the Redskins nursing a 9-second lead, and trouble at the tires now for Peters. No penalty there, however. And now a penalty. That will be double. That'll be 4 seconds, but it will not be enough as Peters comes back strong. Peters did get 4 seconds of penalty at the high bar. His time's 33.75. Hendrick's 30.35. The Redskins win it. Richard Todd is with Mark Mosley.
Mark, your guys are outstanding. You really grouped them together good. Did y'all practice for this?
Well, it's kind of hard to work out for the obstacle course, but we did come out yesterday and try to find six guys that could get over the wall. I think that's one of the hardest things we've ever tried to do as a football team. You're not used to going over walls. You climb a few linemen sometimes. Some of these guys, I don't do much of it, believe me. So it was quite an experience for all of us.
The thing that I was surprised at was the way they got over the high jump bar and the hurdles, especially Nelms.
I tell you, Mike is a fantastic athlete, and we were really thrilled that we all got to come, but especially when Mike came, because we know the kind of athlete he is. He and Tony Peters and Charlie Brown are great athletes, and Mike especially. We had a feeling he might come close to a record today because of that.
How hard was the wall to get over?
Oh, I tell you, it's probably the most difficult thing I ever tried. I know, speaking for myself.
Mark Mosley and his teammates win their second event of the competition, the obstacle course, and they win it by nearly 6 seconds. We've seen a lot of this year. The big, tall high five. Characteristics of the Redskins when they had a successful play. We've seen it before. Here it is again in action. This from the Super Bowl. We'll be back and see how the Skins can swim. Taking the first two events of the Super Teams competition, and coming up next will be the swimming relay. Both the Cards and the Redskins will have a five-man team, Dave Butts got tied up with the lane divider doing a little practice. The divider was the loser, I can tell you that.
Okay, Richard, the football players have the baseball players down 2-0. Swimming coming up. The Redskins, however, in a little bit of trouble.
Well, if they would throw Butts in the water first, I'm sure he could create a tidal wave, maybe knock all the water out, they'd have a better chance. But I don't think they have enough swimmers, is that right?
Well, they're a little short on them. I'll tell you, the baseball team is not the Cardinals. Of course, Tommy won this competition in the men's final, the Superstars. You looking to get back into this competition here, Tommy?
Well, we certainly need to win this swimming event, and realistically, looking into the first two events, we felt our chances weren't real good in that because we brought some of the Clydesdales down from St. Louis, and we didn't think we'd do too well in the speed events, but we're getting in the water now the next couple days, so maybe we can get back into this thing.
All right, let's check it out.
Right now we have an event not on the schedule. That is Joe Theismann wrestling with Richard Todd. In they go. Joe Theismann. Always having a word with you. Always enthusiastic no matter what he does. And the man has to be considered the spiritual leader of the Washington Redskins. High point in his career, no doubt. The Super Bowl victory over the Miami Dolphins, 27-17. This option rollout for Theismann. Here's Charlie Brown. Touchdown, Washington Redskins. It's been an incredibly up year for Joe Theismann, and earlier I talked with him about it.
Joe, it's the line that you gave me in the Pro Bowl. When I asked you if you'd come down yet, you said, no, I'm afraid I'm going to pinch myself and wake up and I'll still be in Hoboken making a speech. Are you coming down any?
A little bit, Frank, but not much. This has been the greatest experience of my life. To win a Super Bowl and to actually live through the after effects of it is the most incredible experience because everywhere you go, people remind you of the Super Bowl event. You know, everybody comes up and says congratulations, and they always preface it with, I guess you've heard this before, but congratulations anyway. And I'm not the least bit put aside by the fact that people continue to say congratulations. It's a wonderful feeling.
The biggest play, perhaps, of the Super Bowl was this in the third quarter. Theismann back. The ball deflected up in the air. Theismann heads up, alertly knocks it out of the arms of Kim Bocamper, and that might have turned the entire game around. Joe recalls the play.
It turned out to be a very, very interesting experience in the Super Bowl when the ball went up in the air. I hate interceptions. There's one thing I hate, it's interceptions. I mean, you can hit me, break me, bust bones, that's fine. But if I throw an interception, I get very upset with myself. And as soon as I threw the ball and Bocamper hit it up in the air, first I had to find it. Because, you know, when a ball gets batted, you look all over and you don't know where it is. And I looked up and I saw it off to my left and I thought to myself, I've got to go get it. But the ball kept drifting further away and Bocamper kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I thought, oh, well. Then I started to slip, and all these thoughts went through my mind. I saw A.J. Dewey running into the end zone with one of Richard's passes, and I said, I don't want that to happen to me. So I made a lunge for an area in between his arms and just happened to time it right. It was really a stroke of luck, but if there's one big play I'd like to be known for, I don't mind being a defensive play in the Super Bowl, believe me.
What makes Joe Theismann run?
Oh, I just think a love for life and enjoyment to be around people and competition. I just thoroughly enjoy competition in every facet of it. I enjoy it in life. I enjoy it in business. And I think the greatest joy I get from it is athletic competition. It's something I've always wanted to be, an athlete. It's something I get great satisfaction out of. And I firmly believe if you lock me in a room one-on-one with somebody in any type of a game, I'll come out of it on top. And I think competition's really what makes it go for me. Plus, I've got a lot of great support. I've got Sherry and the kids, and I think, one of the nicest things about being at the top where we are, and I think I can say that, and I not only speak for myself, but the Washington Redskin organization, is that when you're at the top and you're alone, there's nobody to share it with. But for me to accomplish what I've been able to accomplish through my career and to have my family to share it with, I think really makes it worthwhile. I wouldn't want to be where we are and be alone, but it's so nice to be able to share it with someone.
And sharing a birthday with the son Patrick is Joe Theismann. Joe will be in the swimming when we come back. The swimming relay and the St. Louis Cardinals getting a little bit desperate. They've lost the first two events of the 7-event competition here in the Super Teams. Let's take a look at the way the swimming relay will work. The first swimmer goes 25 yards, followed by three swimmers who will go 50 yards, and then the anchormen, Jim Cott and Dave Butts, will go 25 yards. Getting it underway for the Redskins on your left will be one of the Hogs, offensive tackle George Stark, and Mike Ramsey, the infielder for the Cardinals. That's the record set by the Bengals only a year ago. Stark's a big man, Reggie.
6'5", 250.
Oh, and he left it on the platform as Ramsey got off to a good start. But he used all that height to take the lead right away from Ramsey.
Yes, he did. He's got a pretty good stroke there. I think the advantage that George has there, as a big fellow, he's only got to go 25 yards.
And now for the Redskins. For 50 yards, we'll see Joe Theismann, and it'll be pitcher Bob Forrest for the Cardinals. And look at Forrest go, Reds.
Forrest, a very good swimmer, looks like, Frank. Nice, even, long stroke, and a quick one. We'll see if he's done any swimming when he gets up here. This is a telltale story. Do they do a flip turn? Yes, he does. Not a good one, but he's got one.
And Bob Forrest is pulling away from Joe Theismann. Forrest is giving the Cardinals a commanding lead. And now Forrest will turn it over to Dane Orge, who will also swim 50 yards. Meanwhile, Theismann, as he struggles to touch the wall, he'll be turning it over to one of the other Hogs, offensive guard, Russ Grimm.
Big Russ jumps in, 6'3", 270 pounds, moved the water around pretty good. As Dane Orge, just all he has to do now, just continue that lead and hand it over to his teammate.
Cardinals desperately need a victory here in the swimming competition. They trail 2-0, and they have a lead right now.
Dane looks like he's running out of gas a little bit. I'm sure he's looking for the wall right now. Fighting and fighting and looking. There it is.
And he's looking for Tommy Herr. Tommy Herr, who just a couple of weeks ago won the men's superstars swimming competition. And meanwhile, Mark Mosley is holding his own pretty much with Herr.
Mosley doing a pretty good job there swimming, as we saw a very nice flip turn there by Tom Herr. As he has a nice even stroke as we look, a good firm kick in the water, keeps those bubbles showing all the time, showing some good swimming technique. And here's Mr. Cott.
Mr. Cott, 44 years old, heading into his 25th season. That is a major league record for pitchers, and now here comes Dave Butts. Dave Butts made a splash for you, but Cott now struggling a little bit. I don't think that Butts is going to catch him, but he's going to make it close. Cott reaches out, touches the wall, and the Cardinals are on the scoreboard. They'll win the swimming relay by a time of 2.30, nearly 2.5-second victory. And Reggie's working his way over to talk with Cott.
Kitty caught it. I will not say that you are world class, but I do say that you are a winner. Look like you're about to run out of gas. Only 25 meters.
It's just like during the season. I don't do much. I'm just on the winning team.
That's why they call you short relief.
That's right. Real short.
You guys had to win that race. You were down 2 events, and all of a sudden you come back. Now you're back in it.
Well, the 2 events we lost this morning, they've got some pretty skillful players over there. And we knew Tommy Herr and Bob Forrest, both real good swimmers, so they carried us home.
Outstanding. Bobby Forrest did the big flip turn, and that's what really won the race for you, isn't it? Was it Tommy Herr or Bob Forrest?
It was both of them. I know it wasn't me.
You still look good. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Jim Cott, he made his 25 yards, but again, it was Bob Forrest and Tommy Herr. Let's take a look at Tommy Herr's flip turn in replay. A little dangerous, shallow into the pool, but he comes through with it and extends his lead out over Mark Mosley. And the Cardinals go on to win the swimming relay. Right now, Reggie is with 3 big men.
I want to know, with flippers like those, how could you have possibly not won the swimming?
Well, I'll tell you what, we were a little bit behind. We took Theismann's word again that he could do anything, and he kind of got us behind a little bit. But on the whole, I think we did all right. We made up for a lot of seconds there for a while.
Let me ask you one thing. What size are they?
These are, technically have them measured. They're 12.5 7Es.
7Es?
Which is E.
How do you say that? Septuplet or something like that? There wasn't very much water left in the pool when you guys dove in. Do you know that?
Well, our plan was really to have Dave get the water out of the pool, and then we were going to make it a running race. You know?
And this is one of the Hogs. Is that right?
Correct. Both George and myself, we figured if we keep it within 5 yards into the last 25 with Dave swimming it, we was hoping as soon as he'd hit the water, the wave would kind of push him up on the concrete. But he was already about halfway up the pool, and Dave did his best to catch him. We come close, but... All the light guys did all the running for us this morning, so we figured we'd better try to do our part, and we kind of let them down so we have to make it up something else.
I appreciate it, fellas. I want to all call you misters. I am not a little fella. I'm 6'1". I weigh 212 pounds. Look what they make me look like.
It all depends, Reggie, on the company you keep. The St. Louis Cardinals get on the scoreboard. They win the swimming relay. They now trail 2-1, and volleyball is coming up. Stay with us.
competition, the weather has really moved in here in South Florida. The volleyball, slated for the beach in front of Crandon Park, is underway. Trainer Gene Gieselman of the St. Louis Cardinals on hand. That's Gene on the left, and that is not Peter O'Toole on the right. Earlier, both teams got together before the competition and talked a little bit about strategy.
Everybody's getting toward this way.
No, don't serve like this.
Just play a rusher service. Keep on the front.
Make sure you stay where you are. The back line.
I know so many people talking. That's
front line. Captain talks.
On the front line now, the nets are low, so there's going to be a lot of spiking. If you can block it, do it, but say, don't take a chance. The guys that are backing up, if you can back up those guys on the front line, we're going to have to on these spikes. Because if they miss it, we're going to have back them up.
The best laid plans of mice and men often go astray, and they went astray for the Redskins. We pick up the action. It's 11-7, the Cardinals leading, and George Hendrick has been a very effective server.
You know, I'm not taking anything away from the football players, but every position in baseball, they all work on hand-eye coordination, whether it's batting, whether it's fielding, throwing the ball, so I think the advantage has definitely got to go to the baseball.
And Hendrick picks up another point. That makes it 12-7. Earlier, when the Cards were down 5-3, George Hendrick was serving. He picked up 6 straight points, brought the score to 9-5. Now he has a 12-7 lead, and he's still serving.
George is 6'5". He plays the outfield. He's used to judging balls in the wind, and his serving has been right on key today.
As it ever, it is now 13-7, 2 points away from victory. Oh, and the Redskins this time just let it come into the net. It's 14-7. We have a match point. There's little Patrick Theismann looking on. If he understood the game, he would not be at all too happy with the way things are going with Daddy. Match point, Cardinals, laughing, chuckling it up, well in command. And he gets away from Joe Theismann's diving attempt. And the Cardinals have brought the super teams even. They have 2 victories, and the Redskins have 2. And Theismann, frustrated. I'll take my ball. I'll go home. George Hendrick, the hero of the volleyball competition. And after 4 events of the 7-event competition, it is all tied at 2. The lifeboat race is coming up. That should be something in this weather. Meanwhile, Richard Todd is trying to get Mike Nelms to give us an unusual display of an unusual talent.
Could you give us just one, or you don't want to do them at all?
All right. One, if I can do it right.
Do you have one more you could give us? Just one more?
Cardinals super team captain Darryl Porter is a remarkable man. Darryl came to the Cards as a free agent late in 1980. His career on the line, and as has been widely reported, so too was his life. Porter's comeback was complete this past season. His regular season wasn't that outstanding, but in the World Series, he was the difference. He not only was a clutch hitter, batting .286, but he handled the Cards pitching staff with remarkable finesse. Porter was also a force on defense. And in the 6th game, Porter helped bring the Cards even at 3 games apiece with this home run. The Cards going on to win 13-1. The Cards took game 7, 6-3. They took the World Series, and Darryl Porter was the MVP. It would have been a dream come true for any athlete, and for Darryl Porter, it was truly special. It was the culmination of a dedicated change in lifestyle, and earlier I talked with him about it.
Well, Darryl's been widely talked about, much publicized, but all the major problems seems behind Darryl Porter at this point in life.
They're not behind, Frank, but there's something that I can cope with now. It's been a tough couple of years, but pretty much I've got pretty much control over it now.
As you look back over this past year, and we talked about it a few moments ago, baseball, whatever professional sport it might be, it's either up or down. There seems to be no in between. This has got to be the up point in your life.
No question about it. Being a world champion, I think, is just the greatest thing in the world. You know, as an athlete, you were an athlete, and growing up, all you ever think about, all I remember ever thinking about was being an Olympic champion or being a world champion. And And for that dream to come true, I really dreamt about it a lot, but I don't think I ever believed in my mind that I would ever be one. And now I am one, and I'm so happy. The only thing I'm mad about is we ain't got our ring yet.
Well, you get that soon enough. You think back during those tough times, Daryl, was there ever a point where you said or really thought, oh, to hell with it, it's not worth it, I can't carry on anymore?
I wondered if I would ever come out of it, because I was down. I was down and out completely. I was miserable, and I wondered plenty of times, would I always be like this, or would I be able to finally come to grips with my problem and do something about it? And the whole thing was, I really didn't understand what my problem was at the time. But after Don Newcomb spoke to us in spring training that one year and told us what drugs and alcohol did to a person, I think I finally said at that point, well, maybe the drugs are what's really happening. I thought it was the ups and downs of baseball, my professional life, that had driven me crazy. I really thought that. I really didn't give the drugs and alcohol that much credit. Went away and I stopped doing those things, and it was difficult. Even for a year and a half, it was real difficult, but it's finally come around.
Indeed it has. MVP of the World Series, there haven't been that many of them in the history of the game. Darryl, what's ahead for you?
I've been real awful in baseball the last 2 years, except the end of last year, and I want to reestablish myself as a consistent player. I've never really considered myself a great player, but I've always felt like that I was consistent, and that's what I want to be again.
Daryl Porter, a thoughtful man with a courageous and timely message. Lifeboat racing in some pretty tough water. Here in the Super Teams competition, which is tied now at two events apiece between the Cardinals and the Redskins. A tornado watch is in effect, and heavy winds and rain are coming down right at the moment. The organizers of the event have decided to go ahead with the competition, originally scheduled for the beach in front of the Sonesta Beach Hotel, but it's been moved to Marine Stadium. There will be 8 rowers in each boat. As we look at the Cardinals' boat, there is 1 steersman, and because of the weather conditions, there will be an expert boatsman allowed to occupy each boat. For the Cardinals, they'll have Buzz Tripp with them, and their steersman will be their team captain, Daryl Porter. For the Redskins, the steersman, Big Dave Butts, and I'm sure he coerced the other 8 Redskins to get into that boat in this kind of condition. Their expert boatsman will be Alan Sturman. The course is 400 yards in length. They'll go up and around a buoy twice to the finish line. Reggie and Richard, I don't think either one of you would get in those boats.
You certainly got that right for me, Frank. Inclement weather, just not my style.
They don't play baseball in weather, do they, Reggie?
Absolutely not. How about the football players, Rich?
Well, the football players practiced for about 2 hours yesterday, and they really worked at it hard, and they seem like they had it down. They're going to give it a good shot.
The Cardinals didn't do that much, Frank, but really, yesterday it was 75 degrees. The waters were nice and calm. Look at today. It's a completely different story.
You know, I think the key thing is getting those oars together, and both of them have got that down pretty good, but maybe the most important factor in this lifeboat race is when they get to that buoy, to come around it very tight, because these boats are big, they're heavy, they're not very maneuverable, and coming up will be one of the keys to this entire race. It'll be the first turn. And right now, the Redskins have just a slight lead. They're getting help from their expert boatsman, Alan Sturman. They're coming up on that buoy, and I think you'll see, that's George Stark. He has the black jersey on. Now, he is going to get up, turn around, and now he will back row. That will help Big Dave Butts in the rear of the boat bring the boat tight around the buoy. Let's see if it works.
Now, they talked about in practice how they were going to do that kind of a thing and to help negotiate the turn. But we'll see how the baseball players do with their strategy.
They're doing exactly the same thing, and they have got around the buoy in great shape, and we are just about dead even. Both boats now coming back to the dock, where they'll go around another buoy and then head out and back one more time. Look at that rain pelt down. It's cold in those boats.
Well, I'll tell you, the baseball players coming around the buoy is just like going around second base. They should have a better feel for what's going on.
Are you hedging a little there, Richard?
Yes.
Come on now. Come on now. Those big, strong football players, the finesse of the baseball players.
And now they get Alan Sturman, their expert boatsman. He moves to the back of the boat where he can talk directly right to the Redskins. They still have a little bit of a lead.
They still have a nice, good, even stroke there, the football players do.
Key point again. This will be a turn around the buoy, and the Redskins are going wide, and the Cardinals are staying in tight.
Frank, you know, it looks like the football players are faster, but they're losing it at the turns.
Well, that's bigger.
baseball players, a little better strategy, a little more finesse. And you know, Richard, you don't have to, you know, forget that I'm around. You can address me. You don't have to say when you guys aren't doing well. You can say that we're doing okay as baseball players.
Gentlemen, once again, we're watching the Redskins. They have the speed, they have the strength, they just do not have the finesse in the turns. They go out one more time, just about 100 yards, they make one more turn, then they come back to the finish line. Let's see what happens.
You know, I'm quite impressed, Frank and Richard, that the football players are keeping their boat nice and straight with all that current, with all the inclement weather here. They're really doing a pretty good job. I hope they don't make too good of turns, that's for sure.
And they're using their speed to pull ahead of the Cardinals, but again, they have that turn coming up. What do you think, Richard? They're going to make it?
Well, if they can make a good turn here, they'll have a great chance to win because they can outlast them down the stretch. But they have to make the turn.
Key moment, and they look like they're heading for Africa.
I think a lot of the fellows here, they're only doing four laps, but I'm sure they feel like it's about 4 miles.
Oh, well, if I was in that boat, I'd want to get out with the weather. I'd just jump on the boat with a life jacket.
They went way wide, and the Cardinals, meanwhile, are in very tight. The Cardinals are going to come out of this turn with a commanding lead.
Again, it's nice rhythm, good continuity with the strokes of the oars, and the Cardinals have a real good chance right now. In fact, they're in the lead right now, Frank.
They've taken the lead. The Redskins are trying to come back, but the Cardinals have the lead, and we have a race now to the finish line. Keep in mind, the Redskins are faster, but the Cardinals came out of that final turn with a little bit of a lead. About 50 yards to go. And amazing, there are some people stopped along the highway. They walked over to watch this. They must think they're a bunch of insane people out here in this kind of weather. Look at the Cardinals come. It's going to be close. They're counting off the strokes. A few more yards. The Redskins are coming back, but the Cardinals will take the lifeboat race. And after being down two events to none, all of a sudden the Cardinals are up on top. They have won three events in a row. They lead 3-2 in the overall competition. Here they come into the docks, and I think they're just delighted to be out of the water, as delighted as they are with their victory. These boats weigh 2,000 pounds. They're 30 feet in length, and where the Cardinals won the competition, Richard, was really in the turns. Now, let's take a look at it. These are the Redskins. Now, they went so far wide.
Well, it looks like the football players are much stronger, they're faster, but they lack the finesse for the turns that the baseball players have, and that's where they got beat.
Big Dave Butts doing all that he can do, but here you have seen them go so far out, you do not even see the buoy. Meanwhile, the Cardinals, very exact in their turns. They won it right here. The Cardinals are the victors in the lifeboat race, and Reggie's with them.
You fellas have now won three events in a row, and you're starting to come on strong. Started out two down, two to nothing, and you're coming back strong. What do you think, Mike?
Well, I don't know. I'd say that stuff looks easy on TV, but it ain't that easy. And, you know, I'm just glad we're up right now, 3-2, and try to get them in the next event.
Obie, you were started the course here. It was rough water, bad weather. You guys think about what you were going to do? You hadn't really practiced that much, and looks like the Redskins had strength and everything else over you.
We tried to just stay in a rhythm and try to beat them on the turns, and I think that was the big key for us was the turns, and I think that's where we beat them at.
No, Darrell, looked like you did have some different strategy on your turns. You were making wide turns, and the second time you made the wide turn down at the end, you did beat him in the stretch. Did you have any thoughts on your turn?
Yeah, we wanted on the wind side, the high side, we wanted to stay out quite a ways from the buoy and then kind of work our way in. And on this side, we wanted to try to come down and stay as close to this buoy as we could and cut it short back into the wind. But we wouldn't have done so well, but we was fortunate the weather being like it was, we got to have our crew chief in the boat with us, and he helped us out a lot.
Well, nice going.
Thank you.
The Cardinals with a genuine tribute to their crew chief, Buzz Tripp, who came all the way from Key West to help out. So, after five events, the Cardinals are on top 3-2. If they can win the water relay race, they will lock up the overall competition. Just for the water relay race, Mike needs the work.
Hey, what can I say, huh?
Oh, don't scare the little darling. It's only Dave Butts. Meanwhile, Richard Todd is over with linebacker Rich Pilato, the Redskin.
Rich, you guys won the first two events. You're down by one now. You have to win this one to stay in it. Can you do it?
I think we can. We looked at it earlier. This isn't our strongest event, though. So I think we're going to have some guys, some rowers out there that are going to have to do a little more than they thought they can do. We've got to do this to get to the tug of war. We have to have a 3-3 if we want to walk away the winner. Good luck. Thank you.
Speaking for the Redskins, linebacker Rich Mallott, they know exactly what they have to do. As you can see, here in the third day of the competition, the weather is clear. It is okay for the water relay race. There'll be six men on each team, and they'll use surfboards, and they'll use a paddle boat. It can be a lot of fun with that paddle boat, Reggie, because it is a little bit tricky. Now, the first four men will go up and back two lengths of the pool. The final two will only go one length of the pool. But again, the key is keeping that paddle boat upright. Bob Porsche leads off nearest to you for the Cardinals, and it'll be Charlie Brown of the Redskins. He's over in the far lane. Good start by both of them. Look at Porsche go.
You know, the Redskins, Mallott talks about winning this thing here to stay even. I think the Cardinals are aware that they can clinch the whole thing and not even let it get to the tug of war if they win this race.
Part of a seven-game series that they could win in six. Meanwhile, Charlie Brown, a little slow in the first length of the pool, but he was good on the turn, Reggie.
Yes, he was. We see Mr. Force. Looks like he's starting to fade a little bit as Charlie Brown just continues his single-arm stroke, and now Force is going to the single-arm stroke.
And Charlie Brown has turned the lead over to Mark Mosley, and now Force gives it to Tommy Herbert. Mosley has the lead, and he's paddling well.
Yes, he is. He's real good in practice. As he negotiates his turn out here, let's make note here, while these fellows are doing this, those boats are quite narrow, and the important thing is just to keep the thing straight and keep it right side up.
I'll tell you, you can flip them so quickly you couldn't believe it. Mark Mosley still holds on to the lead. Mosley to turn it over to Joe Theismann. And meanwhile, Herr turns it over to Jim Cott.
We get a real good example here of completely different styles. You see Jim Cott using the butterfly stroke or the double arm stroke. The problem he's having, not like Joe Theismann, using the single arm stroke, negotiating a nice turn. Jim Cott has his feet down in the water, and this is creating a drag on him. He's way back on the board, and he's really causing himself trouble. He isn't going to make it too well. We see that good style of Joe Theismann, single arm or freestyle, and his feet up out of the water, making real good time, Frank.
Theismann and the Redskins are smelling blood as they're the commanding lead. Now Rich Mallott takes over, and meanwhile, all Daryl Porter can do is wait for Jim Cott, who's working his way in.
I think Jim is running out of steam right there.
And now, Daryl Porter takes to the water, but Rich Mallott, who, by the way, did not damage that ankle in the Super Bowl. That was hurt in a pickup basketball game. Boy, look at Porter come back, though.
Porter's really coming on strong. All they can hope for now is to try to pick up some ground, negotiate those turns, and stay up in the boat. Hope for a mistake for the Redskins. That way, the Cardinals will have a shot.
Now the tricky part. Rich Mallott out of the boat. Mike Nelms gets into the boat, and they will go one length of the pool. Meanwhile, Dane Orange gets into Daryl Porter's boat. He will go where? Oh, it's over. How about that?
Yeah, you can sing the song now. Turn out the light. They better hope somebody falls over something as we see Mike Nelms just taking it easy and cruising along. He knows he's got the race run.
And all the Redskins are hovered around the pool. They are cautioning Tony Peters, who will take the final length of the pool, hopefully for a Redskins victory. They could not hardly lose it. Meanwhile, John Stuper is beginning to close down, but it's going to be the Redskins, Reggie.
Yes, it certainly is, and they're getting ready for the celebration. Have a good time. It's party time now.
And it's going to bring up a final of the tug-of-war as John Stuper eases in, perhaps saving a little energy for the tug-of-war, because it's going to come down to that. And we're going to get the customary high five that goes with the victory from the Redskins. All right. So the Redskins have won the water relay race. They got off to a great start. They won the first two events. Then they watched as the Cardinals came back to win three in a row. And now we have it all tied up at three. And once again, it has come down to the tug of war. In the tug of war, you can use as many men as you want, but you have to have a certain amount of weight. 1,500 pounds to be exact, and Molly Force with some of the other wives, Cardinal wives, are figuring out who's going to go up against whom. We'll find out when we come back. Three apiece, it all comes down to the tug of war, and it's worth $33,000 to the winner. Mark Mosley advising his teammates, as is Daryl Porter, as they get ready.
And then when we make our efforts, just make an effort. Don't get carried away if we get an advantage. Just make an effort, okay?
Don't get carried away if we get an advantage. Very optimistic, Daryl Porter. All right, each team has selected seven men. They are close to the 1,500-pound limit. And as you can see, three events apiece. It's all on the line here in the tug-of-war. Joe Theismann
at 195 pounds. And right up front for the Redskins, there's Charlie Brown. He's in there kind of light. Alvin Garrett. He's low to the ground and fairly strong. Mark Mosley has turned out to be a superb athlete as we've watched this competition. Mike Nelms. And Tony Peters. And Richard talks with Dave Butts.
Dave, you're the anchor man at 304 pounds. Obviously, football players should be stronger than baseball players. Are you going to pull us through?
I think the secret of this thing is the number of feet on the ground. I'm definitely going to try to wait down this end and pull like hell, but, you know, it's going to be teamwork, too. So hopefully we can get a little bit quicker off the line because that's what, you know, football is quickness. And I think if we get the jump on them right here, we might be end it quick. If not, we're going to be in for one.
All right, good luck. The whole NFL is watching, okay?
Thanks. No pressure, huh?
Richard, don't agitate him. You forgot he broke your collarbone once. There's Willie McGee for the Cardinals. He's up front. Very light, 170 pounds. Bob Forsh. Now, the Cardinals are pretty good size. They really are. George Hendrick, we told you, he's 6'5 to go with the 213 pounds. Don Stuper, 211 pounds. Dane Orridge is deceptively heavy. And the veteran, Jim Cott, is there. Reggie is going to have a word with the anchorman, Daryl Porter.
Daryl, I guess the football players feel they have an advantage. I mean, do we deserve being underdogs as baseball players? The St. Louis Cardinals deserve being underdogs?
You're not used to that, right?
I think it's going to be pretty difficult for us. But we do have some guys that's got some strong legs. All of our pitchers got good legs, and we've got them in the competition. We were hoping that they'd go with all the really big guys, and we felt like we'd have a real good advantage if we had one extra man. Mm-hmm. But they're doing it right, I think. They're getting seven men on the rope, too, and I just really don't know what to expect.
That is the Redskins' strategy. They have left strong men George Stark and Russ Graham on the bench in favor for a full complement of seven men. Are still within the 1,500-pound time limit. As you can see, the record, 10 seconds flat, set by the Steelers over the Reds in 76, and this one time went for an hour and 15 minutes before there was a 10-minute time limit. Commissioner Bob Cousy lining up that disc right in the middle of the water. And now, we're underway. A little bit of a surge quickly by the Redskins, and they have a little bit of an early edge.
You see an important factor. Willie McGee trying to get his legs underneath him. And again, Dave Butts showing us that your legs are five times stronger than your arms. As we see Daryl Porter, fighting to get his legs underneath him to do the same thing.
There's the disc. It's working right now for the Redskins. They have the advantage. The idea, of course, to pull it beyond those flags, then you are the winner. But if the 10 minutes has expired and you have any kind of an advantage, you are the winner. Well, I'll tell you, Richard, this is grueling.
It really is. You can really tell the Redskins, though, they do have the advantage, and they have like a coach on the sideline, and he tells them when to pull, and they try to all pull together in unison, and that's how they have to win. And if there's one event that's made for the football players, this is it.
Well, I hate to say it, but strength and teamwork. I'm not going to give up, though. The baseball players are smart, and they're going to think of a way to win this thing.
But look at Dave Butts when you say that, at 304 pounds.
Cards are bringing it back just a little bit.
You know, you don't realize how grueling this is. They had to shorten this down for only 10 minutes because when they went an hour and 15 minutes several years ago, fellas felt the pain for almost a week.
You can see it in the faces.
You feel it in your whole body.
Comes the Redskins surge.
Look how they all lean together. They're all giving the command from the coach on the sidelines. They're all going to pull at once. They've got to just try to advance inch by inch.
That's Rich Mallott pacing the sidelines. He's the one who's counting off that one, two, three, and then they give it a huge tug, like right there. Surge by the Redskins, and they pick up even more rope. They're getting close. $33,000 on the line. The Cardinals trying to bring it back.
They're just trying to hold on right now, Frank. That's all.
Come on, Redskins.
Come on, Cardinal. Put something on your back so they don't get pulled through to China, it looks like.
Just one more pull, Dave.
Darryl Porter spotted a sailfish somewhere.
Come on, quit laughing, Darryl.
Here it comes. It's so close.
Look at the legs on big, big butts. Well, they've got 2 and 3 foot holes out there, some of the guys.
One more could do it for the Redskins. There it is.
All right. Oh.
Well, Tuggermore goes to the Redskins. They are the Super Team's champions. 3 minutes, 16 seconds. Not bad. And they did it with a coordinated effort. They are exhausted. Absolutely wiped out. Oh, it's taken a lot out of them. And it'll put a lot in the pocketbook. There was $33,000 riding on this. $30,000 difference between the $50,000 to the winner and the $20,000 to the loser. $3,000 difference for the event. And I'm not sure the Redskins all feel that it was worth it. Richard Todd is over with Joe Theismann.
Joey, you won the whole thing. How do you feel?
Huh? This is pain. I want to be a golfer or something. We feel great. We knew we had to come back. We knew we could get him in the fourth quarter. We did it with spurts and quarterbacks and no hogs. Dan Riley, we love you.
And here's Reggie with Willie McGee.
Willie, you were the smallest guy out there at 170 pounds, and you were the lead fellow. I guess the important thing for you to do was to get him off to a quick start. It didn't happen.
No, my thing was to just get my foot planted. You know, after they started, just lay back and get my foot, my legs braced, and that's what they were basing me on in the front because of my leg strength, I believe. So, fortunately, it didn't work.
Well, good luck to you. Still gave a real super effort.
All right, thank you, Reggie.
Good luck to you.
All right.
Joe Theismann's reference was to the Washington Redskins strength coach, Dan Riley. Final result, the Redskins 4, the Cardinals 3. They win it all. Final high five by the 1983 Super Teams champions, the Washington Redskins. I'd like to thank Reggie Jackson for joining us. Reggie off to the baseball wars, looking for that elusive 500 home run. And for Richard Todd, good luck under his new head coach, Joe Walton. This is the money that was earned by the Washington Redskins, $76,000. Meanwhile, the Cardinals will share all of their earnings with their teammates and coaches who remained at home.